Thank you. Einstein's dreams with us, okay? And I think let's put our hands together to welcome Alan. And his wife, Jean. And of course, we have Professor Ho, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Madhulika, the Vice Chancellor, and Professor Wendy Bong, Dean of Science and Technology, staff to put all this together, all right? I think, I just give a very, very brief introduction about Professor Lightman. I have the privilege of getting to know him almost 50 years ago. So now you know how young we are, all right? That was in 1966, autumn of 1966, and we both graduated in June 1970 from Princeton. I actually have an encounter with Einstein, who actually died in 1955. So you're going to listen to a ghost story, not quite. About my second year, I think, I was in the professor's room, together with a few other students talking about physics and all that. And as usual, they see me lean against the desk by the side of the wall. And then very soon I sat on it. And within 5 minutes, the professor shouted at me, said, "You are sitting on Einstein's desk." So it made me jump, okay? And I have a burning sensation. But that didn't help me, that did not inspire me to go further in physics, because after graduation, I went into the less exact science of economics, and then sociology, and then the messy area of education, and I ended up in the most messy of all, which is called politics. So I went the wrong way, but Alan actually went the right way, because he went on to think about and, you know, theorize about the universe. So he went on to Caltech to get a PhD in astrophysics, Cornell, Harvard, and finally was invited to MIT to head to be the first one to have a double appointment in science and the humanities. Because by then he was already writing novels, fictions, and has become an acclaimed writer. You know, so he has made the right, he has gone into the right track. So I suspect that he must have gone into that professor's office, and instead of sitting on the desk, he actually slept on the desk. And that's how he got Einstein's dreams. So with that introduction, but I must also point out something that 15 years ago, he started to go from science, humanities, into social work. Okay? And he founded a foundation that sponsored the building of schools in Cambodia, and he built two dormitories for female students in universities in Phnom Penh. Okay? And his other area of concern and interest is actually women's advancement. Okay, so that is the topic that you can ask him about later on if we have time. But now let's start with Einstein's dreams. So let's welcome.
Thank you for that wonderful introduction, Tan Shri.
TK,
please. And I want to also say I'm very honored to be here. I want to thank Professor Ho, Professor Mandalika, and Professor Long. I'm very honored to be here, of you, and for this occasion, and I thank TK for a long friendship. I'm going to discuss with you my book, Einstein's Dreams, which I wrote 25 years ago, and I hope to have a conversation with you at part along the way and have you ask questions and make comments about particular chapters. The book, the central figure of the book is, of course, Albert Einstein, the great physicist. And as some of you may know, he proposed a new theory of time called relativity in 1905 when he was working as a clerk in a patent office in Switzerland. And the book is fiction. It consists of a number of fictional dreams that Einstein had while he was thinking about his theory of time. And in each dream, he imagines that time might behave in a different way. In one dream, for example, he imagines that time might be circular, so that we repeat all of our actions over and over and over again. And then the question is, do you remember what you did in the previous cycle? In another dream, time passes more slowly for people the further they are away from the center of Earth. So everyone builds their houses on very tall stilts, so they will be high up, and time will pass more slowly for them. They think they will live longer. In another dream, cause and effect are reversed or sometimes not linked together at all, so that effect does not always follow cause. And without a cause and effect relationship, people cannot predict the future. So everyone is confused all the time in this world. So in each dream, which takes place on a different night, there's a different concept of time, and then I explore the consequences for human relationships with that kind of time. In the book, I explore the psychological aspects of time as much as the physical aspects of time. It's a complete fiction, though. Einstein did not record his dreams except for maybe three dreams in his entire lifetime, so the book is a total fiction. Well, I think from what I've said so far, you can tell that it's sort of an unusual novel. It's an unusual fiction because besides Einstein, there are really no major characters. There's no continuing narrative or plot as there is in most novels. And so it's really, it's hard to put the book into a definite category. And when I wrote the book 25 years ago, I had written a number of books before this book, and I've written many books since this book. when I took it to publishers, the first couple of publishers, it was rejected because the publishers didn't really understand what kind of book it was, what category it was in. But then finally, it was accepted by publisher, and the editor there in the publishing house did not think the book would do very well commercially, and so I got only a very small amount of money in advance for the book. Well, then to everyone's surprise, and to my surprise as well, the book did extremely well commercially and made a lot of money. And as TK mentioned, it has been translated into 30 languages. Unfortunately, Malay is not one of the languages that it is in. It has also been adapted by artists, dancers, musicians, theater playwrights all over the world. There have been 100 different adaptations of the book all over the world in different forms. I'll show you some short video clips of some of those. I have not had anything to do with the adaptations. I think that when you have a work of art in one medium, when it's transferred to a different medium, like when a novel is made into a film, that the new artist has to have an independent vision of what to do with the material. And so my policy has been to stay out of the way. Let me tell you a tiny bit about myself before I start talking about the book, because it relates to the book. I grew up in the southern part of the United States, and from an early age I was interested in both science and the arts together. I wrote poetry and stories, and I also did scientific experiments. And my teachers, my friends, and my parents all tried to push me in one direction or the other. Either it be the scientist type, who's deliberate, who tries to predict things, who's analytical, or the artistic type, the more intuitive, more fanciful. And I resisted those forces. I held on to both my double interest in the sciences and the arts. I think that young people in general, I think that many young people have an interest in both the sciences and the arts, and society pushes them in one direction or the other. And I always encourage my students at the various universities that I've taught at that if they have an interest in both the sciences and the arts, they should try to hold on to both interests. Then I went to college, and as TK mentioned, we became friends. We were classmates. We lived very close to each other. TK and I were both physics majors. He sat on Einstein's desk, and I slept on the desk. But we both had different interests besides physics. TK was very, very good with people. His manner with people, his management, his organizational skills, his interest in politics. I was not so good at any of those things. But I had an interest in the arts and an interest in philosophy. And my book, Einstein's Dreams, is really a synthesis of science, the arts, and philosophy. Let me give you a brief biography of Einstein, and then I'll turn to the book itself. Maybe many of you already know a lot about Einstein. He was born in 1879 in a little town in Germany called Ulm, U-L-M. From an early age, he was not like most of the other boys. He was more inward. When he spoke to people, he always muttered every sentence twice to himself silently before he said it out loud. up until about the age of 10. That's the way that he talked to people. Instead of playing with the other boys, he liked to stay at home and solve puzzles. And his parents thought that he might be slow intellectually. He had very bad experiences in school. He was in the German gymnasium school, and when he was 10 or 12 years old, when he took a mathematics class, the way that his teacher taught the multiplication tables is she would slap the students with a ruler if they missed a figure, if they would do it wrong. And Einstein associated this kind of behavior with the general authoritarian mentality of Germany as he saw at that time. And at age 16, he actually gave up his German citizenship at age 16. Now, to think about how independent-minded, how courageous, and how fiercely independent a young person would have to be to give up their national citizenship at age 16. So he gave up his German citizenship at age 16. He really disliked the authoritarian mindset of Germany. He moved to Italy for a couple of years where his parents were living. Well, I forgot to mention that his parents, his mother was a musician, and he learned the violin at an early age and loved it for the rest of his life. His father was a businessman, but not a very successful businessman. He was in the electrical business, and his businesses kept failing and going bankrupt. And he would move from one business to another, from one town to the other. His father would move from one city to the other as each business failed. So he went to university in Switzerland at the Zurich, at the Polytechnic in Zurich, and finished in 1900. And then he applied for graduate school at German-speaking countries in Europe, and he was turned down by all of them. And it is believed, almost certain, that he was turned down because his professors at the Polytechnic in Zurich did not write letters of recommendation for him. And the reason they didn't is because he often had challenged them in class. He was not the obedient student who bows down to their professors. He realized, even at age 18, that he was smarter than most of his professors, and he did not bow down to them. And so for that reason, his professors did not recommend him from graduate school. So he had to tutor for 2 years in math and science after finishing his undergraduate degree, his first degree. And finally, in 1902, he got a job at the patent office in Bern, Switzerland. So he worked there for a few years. And then in 1905, at the age of 26, he published 5 papers. This is while he was working at the patent office. He was not in a university setting. He was working on his own, and he published 5 papers in that year, any one of which could have won him the Nobel Prize. This is age 26. And one of those papers was on his theory of time, the theory of relativity. I'll say a couple of words about relativity, and then I'm done with all of the prelude here. Einstein did not set out to propose a new theory of time. First of all, for thousands and thousands of years, no one had questioned the nature of time. Time is so fundamental, it's so basic, we start learning about time while we're still in the womb of our mothers. Everyone assumed that time was just time, that it was absolute, that if you had two identical clocks, they would tick at the same rate. That's what I mean by absolute time. And what Einstein proposed in 1905 is that actually time is relative to motion. If you have two identical clocks that are in motion with respect to each other, that they do not tick at the same rate, that each clock sees the other clock ticking more slowly. He did not, when he was working in the patent office in 1905, he did not set out to propose a new theory of time. Instead, he was working on electricity and magnetism, and certain experiments in electricity and magnetism had suggested to him that there is no such thing as absolute rest, that you cannot say that you're traveling at an absolute speed of 100 meters per second or 100 kilometers per second, that all speed is relative. You can only say how fast you are traveling relative to something else. There's no absolute frame of rest, point of rest in the universe. And when he applied that almost philosophical idea to electricity and magnetism, he found that the concept of time had to be revised, that you needed a relativity of time. So that's all I'm going to say about the theory of relativity. And what I'd like to do now, I'm going to read a couple of sections from the book. After each section, I would like you to invite you to ask questions, to explore ideas for a few minutes, maybe 10 or 15 minutes. Then I'm going to show you one of the videos, a short section, maybe 3 to 5 minutes video, of one of the artistic productions that's been made from the book. And then I'll read a different chapter and again invite questions from you, and then show another video. And we will do all of that for about an hour or until you get tired. But if we all run around the room very, very rapidly, an hour will seem like only 3 minutes. So I'm going to start with the very beginning of the book, which is the prologue, and this sort of sets up the entire book. So this is page 1 of the book. In some distant arcade, a clock tower calls out 6 times and then stops. The young man slumps at his desk. He has come to the office at dawn after another upheaval. His hair is uncombed and his trousers are too big. In his hand, he holds 20 crumpled pages, his new theory of time, which he will mail today to the German Journal of Physics. Tiny sounds from the city drip through the room. A milk bottle clinks on a stone. An awning is cranked in a shop on Markgasse. A vegetable cart moves slowly through a street. A man and woman talk in hushed tones in an apartment nearby. In the dim light that seeps through the room, the desks appear shadowy and soft, like large sleeping animals. Except for the young man's desk, which is cluttered with half-open books, the 12 oak desks are all neatly covered with documents left from the previous day. Upon arriving in 2 hours, each clerk will know precisely where to begin. But at this moment, in this dim light, the documents on the desks are no more visible than the clock in the corner or the secretary's stool near the door. All that can be seen at this moment are the shadowy shapes of the desks and the hunched form of the young man. 6:10. By the invisible clock on the wall. Minute by minute, new objects gain form. Here, a brass wastebasket appears. There, a calendar on a wall. Here, a family photograph, a box of paper clips, an inkwell, a pen. There, a typewriter, a jacket folded on a chair. and time, the ubiquitous bookshelves emerge from the night mist that hangs on the walls. The bookshelves hold notebooks of patents. One patent concerns a new drilling gear with teeth curved in a pattern to minimize friction. Another describes a typewriter with a low-velocity type bar that eliminates noise. It is a room full of practical ideas. Outside, the tops of the Alps start to glow from the sun. It is late June. A boatman on the Aare unties his small skiff and pushes off, letting the current take him along Aarestrasse to Germangasse, where he will deliver his summer apples and berries. The baker arrives at his store in Markgasse, fires his coal oven, begins mixing flour and yeast. Two lovers embrace on the Nideck bridge, gaze wistfully into the river below. A man stands on his balcony on Schifflava, studies the pink sky. A woman who cannot sleep walks slowly down Kramgasse, peering into each dark arcade, reading the posters in half light. In the long, narrow office on Spikergasse, the room full of practical ideas, the young patent clerk still sprawls in his chair, head down on his desk. For the past several months, since the middle of April, he has dreamed many dreams about time. His dreams have taken hold of his research. His dreams have worn him out, exhausted him, so that he sometimes cannot tell whether he is awake or asleep. But the dreaming is finished. Out of many possible natures of time, imagined in as many nights, one seems compelling. Not that the others are impossible. The others might exist in other worlds. The young man shifts in his chair, waiting for the typist to come, and softly hums from Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata. When you read one of the dreams, each dream has the title of the day that he dreamed it. So this is 24 April 1905. In this world, there are two times. There is mechanical time, and there is body time. The first is as rigid and metallic as a massive pendulum of iron that swings back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. The second squirms and wriggles like a bluefish in a bay. The first is unyielding, predetermined. The second makes up its mind as it goes along. Many are convinced that mechanical time does not exist. When they pass the giant clock on the Kramgasse, they do not see it, nor do they hear its chimes while sending packages on Postgasse or strolling between flowers in the Rosengarten. They wear watches on their wrists, but only as ornaments or as courtesies to those who would give timepieces as gifts. They don't keep clocks in their houses. Instead, they listen to their heartbeats. They feel the rhythms of their moods and desires. Such people eat when they're hungry, go to their jobs at the millinery or the chemist whenever they wake up from their sleep, make love at all hours of the day. Such people laugh at the thought of mechanical time. They know that time moves in fits and starts. They know that time struggles forward with a weight on its back when they are rushing an injured child to the hospital or bearing the gaze of a neighbor wrong. And they know, too, that time darts across the field of vision when they are eating well with friends or receiving praise or lying in the arms of a secret lover. Then there are those who think that their bodies don't exist. They live by mechanical time. They rise at 7 o'clock in the morning. They eat their lunch at noon and supper at 6. They arrive at their appointments on time precisely by the clock. They make love between 8 and 10 at night. They work 40 hours a week, read the Sunday paper on Sunday, play chess on Tuesday nights. When their stomachs growl, they look at their watch to see if it is time to eat. When they begin to lose themselves in a concert, they look at the clock above the stage to see when it will be time to go home. They know that the body is not a thing of wild magic, but a collection of chemicals, tissues, and nerve impulses. Thoughts are no more than electrical surges in the brain. Sexual arousal is no more than a flow of chemicals to certain nerve endings. Sadness no more than a bit of acid transfixed in the cerebellum. In short, the body is a machine subject to the same laws of electricity and mechanics as an electron or a clock. As such, the body must be addressed in the language of physics. And if the body speaks, it is the speaking only of so many levers and forces. The body is a thing to be ordered, not obeyed. Taking the night air along the River Ara, one sees evidence for two worlds in one. A boatman gauges his position in the dark by counting seconds drifted in the water's current. 1, 3 meters, 2, 6 meters, 3, 9 meters. His voice cuts through the black and clean and certain syllables. Beneath the lamppost on the Nidic Ridge, two brothers who haven't seen each other for a year stand and drink and laugh. The bell of St. Vincent's Cathedral sings 10 times. In seconds, lights in the apartments on Shiflava wink out in a perfect synchronized response, like the deductions of Euclid's geometry. Lying on the riverbank, two lovers look up lazily, awakened from a timeless sleep by the distant church bells, surprised to find the night has come. Where the two times meet, desperation. Where the two times go their separate ways, contentment. For, miraculously, a barrister, a nurse, a baker can make a world in either time, but not in both times. Each time is true, but the truths are not the same. Well, I'm going to pause for a few minutes and ask you for comments or questions on what I've read so far. And I intended for each chapter to provoke thought, philosophical considerations. Any comments or questions? And you don't have to confine your questions to the chapter I've read. Yes. Did everyone hear that? The question was, in the mechanical time, in the body time, am I describing two completely different kinds of people, or is it possible for a single person to slip back and forth between the two kinds of time, or the two ways of viewing the world, experiencing the world? That's a good question. I'll give some comment about that, then I would like other people to comment on your interesting question. I think, of course, in my view, it's possible for people to have both modalities in them, sometimes acting more mechanically and sometimes more intuitively. In order to make the point in the chapter, sometimes you need to make things extreme. So in the writing of the chapter, I wrote it as if there were two completely separate, distinct groups of people who live in different ways. Have any of you met people that you could classify as either the mechanical type or the body type? Professor Hose is the mechanical type.
So I'd like to actually believe that when we have discussion over our own time, each one of us, when we have, when I'm at, you know, control of my own time, then I'd like to be the body time kind of person.
Yeah.
But when you are within an organization, when you have to move according, you slip into a mechanical sense.
Yes.
You don't have choice or discretion over the use of your time.
Yes.
So I personally, when you were talking like that, I was thinking into both.
Yes.
As a person, I would like to at all times be able to be a body type person, but there are times where you don't
yes.
have that luxury.
Yes. Well, Professor Maulika says that she would like to be body time always, but when she has to do certain professional things like go to meetings, that she must be mechanical time. One of the aspects of this of the chapter that I read, one of the ideas that I was playing with is the material view of the body or the human being versus the non-material view. This, of course, is a very deep philosophical question, theological as well as philosophical, that has been debated for thousands of years and will probably keep being debated. Would anybody like to comment on that dichotomy, the material world versus the non-material world?
Could I try? I'm not sure whether it was quite as clear, but I thought some of the statements you made earlier seem to have given answers. You said you spoke about the body ought to be ordered to something to take effect. So that's how I behave. I feel hungry, but I look at the time whether it works from the central body, no time. So
you're ordering your body.
Pardon?
Your mind is ordering your body.
Well, because I know my body can cheat me. It will make the clock go faster. So I suppose the body is going to be open to some mechanical form.
That's for you. Is anyone else on one?
You just did it. You need to.
Any comments on the material versus the non-material view of reality? Of course, the most important reality to us is our own bodies.
Yes.
I'm not sure my question is relevant to this.
Yes.
What you say about body time and mechanical time. Now, I can give you my own experience. Let's say I used to get up at 7 a.m. in the morning, but one day I had to get up at 5 a.m. I would set an alarm clock, I should wake me up at 5 a.m. But I would get up at 5 o'clock and stop the alarm clock. I get up first to listen to the alarm clock. And sometimes when I do some meditation, breathing, I'll set my alarm clock, say the last one, half an hour. And then I will open my eyes, then I hear the alarm clock, alarm clock. So what, how do you describe this phenomenon?
Well, I think that you have you have an internal clock in your mind that has a sense of the passage of time and is keeping track of time. So, I mean, we know that there are many biorhythms in the body, and so I would say that you have a good internal clock.
You don't need a clock.
You don't need a clock. Yes.
This is a dream. It's a dream that takes place in 1905. External to the dream, there's of course only one time. Not two. In the dream, he now says, well, maybe there shouldn't be just one time. Maybe there's two times. Why is he limited to two? Why not three?
Well, so the question is, why limit the dreams to two times and not three or four? That's a great question. I wanted to, in writing this, I wanted to explore the difference between the mechanical and the more spiritual or more body-centered. So, for purposes of that exploration, I made it just two times. But if you're right.
The breakthrough was going from one to something else.
Yes. There's another dream, which I'm not going to read, in which Einstein imagines that the time, like space, is multidimensional. And there are several dimensions of time. It's a good question. It raises the question of what I was trying to do with the book. And each dream, when I was writing the book, so this was more than 25 years ago, for each chapter, I started off with some human behavioral or philosophical or psychological idea that I wanted to explore. And then I imagined or invented a way that time would behave that would explore that idea. And then I created a little human story, a human narrative to go with that. I also I like irony and paradox. In many of the chapters, I put a little ironical twist at the end, which you'll see as I read a couple more.
I'm interested in the way that you come. By the way, I've just only downloaded the book. Shame on me! I didn't read this before. I noticed that you have structures to the book. You started with an interlude and a lot of dates, and then an interlude, and then an epilogue.
Yeah.
What prompted you to have this kind of ups and downs?
It's a very good question. Did everyone hear the comment? The
By the way, I'm the kind of reader, when I got Harry Potter 7, I read from the back.
So the question is asking me about the structure of the book. That there's a prologue, and there are a few dreams, which are like diary entries. Then there's a waking interlude in which Einstein is awake, working in a patent office. Then there are a few more dreams, diary entries. Then another interlude where he's waking and talking to his friend in the patent office. And then an epilogue at the end. When I originally had the concept for the book, I just had the dreams and no interludes. And then I began thinking, how is this going to feel as a reading experience? And I thought that you needed a little bit of dramatic motion through the book. You need a little bit of something that has a chronology, that has a narrative to it. So I introduced the interludes that take place at later and later points of time. In the first interlude, Einstein begins to talk to his friend that he's thinking of a theory of time. Then in the second interlude, he's further along in that thinking. And finally, at the end of the book, he's completed his exploration of time and is waking up again in the patent office. So the purpose of the interludes structurally is to provide some kind of narrative glue to hold all of the dream worlds, the dreams together. That's a very good question. I think that even though I said at the beginning that this little book, and you can see how little it really is, it's very, very thin. I think one of the reasons for the success of this book is that it's very, very small. You can read most of it while sitting in the loo. It's very small. I think that even though it's not a traditional novel, that it does need some kind of narrative glue to hold it together. Yes?
Yeah, I was very interested in two comments. One first is Einstein's inability to work. Reminds me of Winter, he also had the same problem.
Yeah.
Seems like that he will drop off of writing and not working. And even the unit was they all became harmless. Coming back to the question of theory of that, one of the problems that Einstein had, from the little that I know, the sun figure that I had, he had problems in fixing theory. Everything was relative, property, and he could not find something to which you could compare anything to something. I'm black because you're white, so that's the right. So who is the right base to do? So he had that problem, and he came to the conclusion that time was the one thing that is absolute.
No.
Anything else would be. Correct me if I'm wrong.
No, that's not right.
Okay, and from that theory, that idea came, the idea of relativity. So therefore, time traditionally was fixed on the rising of the sun. That's how men came out with the idea of time itself. But that is inaccurate, not very scientific. So eventually, it became fixed to planetary movements. And there are certain stars that appear correctly on a split second dot. It was through Einstein's work that this was eventually discovered. Time became fixed. So that seemed to me perception on the little that I know.
Well, some of your perception is right and some of it is wrong. Time is not fixed. If you have two identical clocks that are moving relative to each other, they will not tick at the same rate. It will appear to each clock that the other clock is ticking more slowly. And in fact, we have confirmed that with laboratory experiments, the time moves more slowly from the point of view of the person who's at rest looking at the other person. We've observed it with elementary particles. If you have an identical twin, and that twin goes out and travels in a spaceship and goes very, very rapidly and comes back, when they return, they will be younger than you. And we have done that equivalent thing, not with people, but with subatomic particles. The second thing that you mentioned about the light of the stars getting split, you're referring to the bending of light that was measured in 1917 by Arthur Eddington. And that was a test of Einstein's theory of gravity, not his theory of time. They're both called relativity. One is the special theory of relativity, which deals with time, and the theory that deals with gravity is called the general theory of relativity. So I think I'm going to I know this lady here had a question, so let me, please. Here is that when I'm talking about mechanical time, that is sort of a linear view of time, and the body time is more of a spiritual, cyclical view of time. Very interesting comment.
And I think it kind of falls back into pessimism. In Buddhism, life is actually cyclical.
Yes, yes. Yes, in Buddhism, everything repeats in cycles until you get to nirvana. Yes, and I think I've become much more Buddhist since writing the book. My wife, Jean, who is here, is actually quite a student of Buddhism, and I've learned a lot about it from her. So I think we're going to show one video now, and let me just tell you what this is. As I said, there's been many independent artistic productions around the world, dance, theater, music, based on this book. And I'm going to show you a theatrical production, or little bits of a theatrical production in Beijing, China, a few years ago, using students from the University of Beijing as actors. So it's going to come in two bits. And the first bit shows them in person.
Look at the atmosphere. 1 month before the end, business is closed.
there because it's hard to understand the dialogue, and I just want you to see that they're performing the play in Beijing. So what I'd like to do now is to read another chapter from the book and again get some comments from you. And I really enjoyed your comments from the first section that I read. This is the dream from 26 April 1905. In this world, it is instantly obvious that something is odd. No houses can be seen in the valleys or plains. Everyone lives in the mountains. At some time in the past, scientists discovered that time flows more slowly the further from the center of Earth. The effect is minuscule, but it can be measured with extremely sensitive instruments. Once the phenomenon was known, a few people, anxious to stay young, moved to the mountains. Now, all houses are built on Dom, the Matterhorn, Monte Rosa, and other high ground. It is impossible to sell living quarters elsewhere. Many are not content simply to locate their houses on a mountain. To get the maximum effect, they have constructed their houses on stilts. The mountaintops all over the world are nested with such houses, which from a distance look like a flock of fat birds squatting on long, skinny legs. People most eager to live longest have built their houses on the highest stilts. Indeed, some houses rise half a mile high on their spindly wooden legs. Height has become status. When a person from his kitchen window must look up to see a neighbor, he believes that neighbor will not become stiff in the joints as soon as he, will not lose his hair until later, will not wrinkle until later, will not lose the urge for romance as early. Likewise, a person looking down on another house tends to dismiss its occupants as spent, weak, and short-sighted. Some boast that they have lived their whole lives high up, that they were born in the highest house on the highest mountain peak and have never descended. They celebrate their youth in their mirrors and walk naked on their balconies. Now and then, some urgent business forces people to come down from their houses, and they do so with haste, hurrying down the tall ladders to the ground, running to another ladder or to the valley below, completing their transactions, and then returning as quickly as possible to their houses or to other high places. They know that with each downward step, time passes just a little bit faster and they age a little more quickly. People at ground level never sit. They run while carrying their briefcases or groceries. A small number of residents in each city have stopped caring whether they age a few seconds faster than their neighbors. These adventurous souls come down to the lower world for days at a time, lounge under the trees that grow in the valleys, swim leisurely in the lakes that lie at warmer altitudes, roll on level ground. They hardly look at their watches and can't tell you whether it is Monday or Thursday. When the others rush by them and scoff, they just smile. In time, people have forgotten the reason why higher is better. Nevertheless, they continue to live on the mountains, to avoid sunken regions as much as they can, to teach their children to shun other children from low elevations. They tolerate the cold of the mountains by habit and enjoy the discomfort as part of their breeding. They have even convinced themselves that thin air is good for their bodies, and following that logic, have gone on spare diets, refusing all but the most gossamer food. At length, the populace have become thin like the air, bony, old before their time. So I'll stop there, and questions or comments? This one, of course, has that ironical twist at the end that I try to achieve in many of the chapters. This dream, of course, is much more about society and social status. Yes. Time is human-made, that we create time, and what would happen if we remove time altogether from our vocabulary, just removed it as a concept, and lived without time. Well, first of all, I would say that I would like to distinguish between the physical time, the physical nature of time, and the psychological and cultural construction of time. I'd like to distinguish between those two. Einstein was really concerned about the physical nature of time. And when he thought about time and proposed his theory of relativity, he was proposing an explanation for what clocks measure. You can construct a clock, and you can one way to construct a clock is has a pendulum to swing back and forth, and you just made a clock. And that pendulum is measuring something. And Einstein was concerned with what happens if you have two clocks that are moving relative to each other. What is their relative ticking rate? And he actually worked out a theory of time, physical time, which is quantitative. He actually worked out mathematically what is the exact difference in ticking rate depending on the relative speed? Quantitative formula for that, and that has been confirmed by laboratory experiments where we can measure time, for example, by the number of oscillations of an atom, where the atom is oscillating back and forth. That's a kind of atomic clock, and we can show with that measure of time that Einstein's theory of relativity is actually correct. That's a physical kind of time, and we need that kind of time to make our computers run, for example. All computers have an internal clock that tells them when to do the next operation, and since you have a lot of different operations going on at once in your computer, you need to have them synchronized in time for that to work. Our GPS system works on the quantitative nature of time. If you didn't have very accurate clocks, you wouldn't be able to use the GPS system. So we need physical time. That would be my first response. But I think that your point is very, very interesting if I interpret it in terms of the cultural and psychological experience of time. And I do agree with you that for many things that we do in our civilization and in our society, that time is a human construction. And I know that there are some cultures that have a very different sense of time, a very different experience of time. And I think it's a wonderful question about what would happen if we could remove time from our vocabulary altogether. It would have to be limited to the society, because we do need the physical nature of time, the physical time for the things that I was mentioning, the computers, the GPS, and many other parts of our technology that require a concept of time, in fact, a quantitative concept of time. Would anybody else like to comment on the possibility and the consequences and implications of removing time as a concept from our culture, from our society, from our daily life? Yes?
In July of 1970, shortly after the time that two of you graduated from Princeton, I was in New Guinea. And I happened to be at a place called Pig Island, which is an uninhabited island. And while there, I met two New Guineans who come from a neighboring island. And I asked them, where is it? They said, it's over there, in Pigeon. I asked them, how far is it? Notion of distance didn't mean anything. It's over there. So I then said, well, how long did it take you to get here? In your canoe. Notion of time meant nothing. And I can tell you the effect that it had on me. I all of a sudden met some people that I had no basis to. I had a real problem trying to discuss a little bit about where they came from. Because for them, the notion of distance and time didn't mean anything. Or at least nothing that they could explain to me or that I could understand. But that's a true story.
Mm-hmm. A wonderful story. Anybody else have any other comments to make about the cultural construction of time or the possibility of removing time from our culture?
I mean, when you just possibly said, when you remove total concept of time, what is mentioned and like what is different, say, then how do sequence of events happen? A comes before B, or C comes before A, and everything will be topsy-turvy.
So you think it would eliminate cause and effect, or the relative order of events? Well, you could still say that A came before B, but just not know how much before it came.
No, A came. No, you have A, B, C, D, E. No, B can come before even A. And then B will come after D, or whatever it is. So how do you really reconcile that?
Okay. So my question for you now is, if you would not be able to tell which events came before other events, would that be a problem for you? It would be a problem?
To eat dinner before breakfast.
To give a simple example, in a traffic light, you have green, you have orange, the time is in a random way, so the traffic is in a mess. So without flash, without traffic control,
yes.
The whole traffic is in a mess. So we are all in a mess.
Yes. So the comment here was that if we didn't have clear sequences of events and time for traffic lights, for example, the green light comes first, then the orange light when you have to begin slowing down, and the red light to stop, that you would have traffic jams and you would have a mess and you wouldn't be able to drive around, navigate. So that's sort of a practical application of time.
So the way we learn to derive meaning of traffic lights is a chronologically determined for what happened before, what happens after. Therefore, you know, the growing of the tide, the maturing of families, maturing of the time, you see, I mean, there's a chronology that may determine meaning.
Yes.
All the big pieces happen, what follows what, and therefore, I wouldn't really say that time determines a cause and effect relationship, but we learn to understand chronologically that if this proceeds, a sum of sequence is likely to happen. So a meaning of life around us is sort of, in a sense, chronologically constructed.
So the comment here was that we cannot give meaning to our lives in the different stages and events in our lives without some kind of chronology, without being, say, this came first and then this happened and this happened. But that's how we make sense of our lives. Yes?
I think our original question was the cultural perception of time. I think it's not a matter of whether there is or there is no chronological sequence, but the importance culture plays on time. And a good reflection of culture is language. The English language is very time-centered. There's a past, perfect, past, present, new, and future tense. Whereas in other language, for example, the famous example, the Hopi language, whereby it's not time-based. So the original idea of that, I mean, does our culture, as reflected in our language, influence our perception of time? And based on different perception of time, we'll have a different worldview, and therefore a different reality.
Yes. That comment here was...
I'd like to continue with what you said, because I think my point is quite different.
Yes, I'll repeat it.
Time seems to be a Western concept. Traditional societies, rural society, time, people did not live with time. Now you see progress has become so much easier by time and we die with time. People enjoyed life, social, we did not measure time. We measured relationships, we measured things, events that were going on. That was what was important. The events were focused. Boundaries, times, and all that were all very distant. So that's why the language is
So the comment
and
just
the,
now
one
was...
One of the things the British did when they came to any colonial society is to put a clock tower.
So the comment here was that the measurement of time is a Western concept.
Oh, no, the idea of time
the,
is...
The idea of time is a Western idea, and that other cultures who do not have that concept live in a different way. And the comment over here was that that time is reflected in language, and the example was used of a lot of time-centered language being English, where there are many different verb tenses to indicate when something happened or this happened before that. Versus other languages, and the example was the Hopi language, where there aren't any tenses to the verbs, and there's a completely different concept of time. So those are wonderful comments. A question that I would throw out to you, and I don't want this to sound Western-centered, even though I'm from the West, But the Hopi, let's use the Hopi people as an example, who do not have a sense of time that's anywhere like our sense of time. could they have developed certain technology that requires very accurate measurement of time? For example, could they have developed the computer or very accurate clocks? And I say that as a sincere question. I don't mean to pass judgment. I think all of the different cultures and their different experience with time are very valuable and rich and teach us different ways that we can live. I think I'm going to now show the next video. And this is the dance. This is a musical piece that was based on the book. And
my favorite baker with the thick fingers is again throwing dough in the oven. Is again smiling at customers.
So one of the chapters was set to music.
And the couple is underneath that street now, getting to know each other one more time and being scared. Just use it.
This is in Michigan, in the United States, this orchestra. Lyrics come from the book, but the guitarist is a man named Randall Williams. I'd like to read you one more, one last dream and have a discussion afterwards. This is the dream of 14th May 1905. There is a place where time stands still. Raindrops hang motionless in air. Pendulums of clocks float mid-swing. Dogs raise their muzzles in silent howls. Pedestrians are frozen on the dusty streets, their legs cocked as if held by strings. The aromas of dates, mangoes, coriander, cumin are suspended in space. As a traveler approaches this place from any direction, he moves more and more slowly. His heartbeats grow farther apart, his breathing slackens, his temperature drops, his thoughts diminish until he reaches dead center and stops. For this is the center of time. From this place, time travels outward in concentric circles, at rest at the center, slowly picking up speed at greater distances. Who would make pilgrimage to the center of time? Parents with children and lovers. And so, at the place where time stands still, one sees parents clutching their children in a frozen embrace that will never let go. The beautiful young daughter with the blue eyes and blonde hair will never stop smiling the smile she smiles now, will never lose the soft pink glow on her cheeks, will never grow wrinkled or tired, will never get injured, will never unlearn what her parents have taught her, will never think thoughts that her parents don't know, will never know evil, will never tell her parents that she does not love them, will never leave her room with the view of the ocean, will never stop touching her parents as she does now. And at the place where time stands still, one sees lovers kissing in the shadows of buildings in a frozen embrace that will never let go. The loved one will never take his arms from where they are now, will never give back the bracelet of memories, will never journey far from his lover, will never place himself in danger and self-sacrifice, will never fail to show his love, will never become jealous, will never fall in love with someone else, will never lose the passion of this instant in time. One must consider that these statues are illuminated by only the most feeble red light, for light is diminished almost to nothingness at the center of time, its vibrations slowed to echoes in vast canyons, its intensity reduced to the faint glow of fireflies. Those not quite at dead center do indeed move, but at the pace of glaciers. A brush of the hair might take a year, a kiss might take a thousand. While a smile is returned, seasons pass in the outer world. While a child is hugged, bridges rise. While a goodbye is said, cities crumble and are forgotten. And those who return to the outer world, children grow rapidly, forget the centuries-long embrace from their parents, which of them lasted but seconds. Children become adults, live far from their parents, live in their own houses, learn ways of their own, suffer pain, grow old. Children curse their parents for trying to hold them forever, curse time for their own wrinkled skin and coarse voices. These now old children also want to stop time, but at another time, they want to freeze their own children at the center of time. Lovers who return find their friends are long gone. After all, lifetimes have passed. They move in a world they do not recognize. Lovers who return still embrace in the shadows of buildings, but now their embraces seem empty and alone. Soon, they forget the centuries-long promises, which to them lasted only seconds. They become jealous even among strangers, say hateful things to each other, lose passion, drift apart, grow old and alone in a world they do not know. Some say it is best not to go near the center of time. Life is a vessel of sadness, but it is noble to live life, and without time there is no life. Others disagree. They would rather have an eternity of contentment, even if that eternity were fixed and frozen, like a butterfly mounted in a case.
I find, you know, this connecting to the next chapter, somehow you're like a proponent for dying very dramatically. For example, just look like what happened to David Bowie. He died in a sudden manner 3 days after the album. So what happens to him is that his immortality of the album Backstar, and what would have happened with the album, he's actually stuck in time. Because we don't know what's going to happen next. If he actually died, you know, perhaps a year after the album, we would not have, you know, we would not have created a kind of awe and wonder about the person. The same thing with Lady Diana, Princess Diana. If she would have lived a long life, you know, it doesn't resonate to her, because he said in the next chapter, imagine a world in which there is no time, only images. Because what we have of David Bowie is 3 days after his death, here comes something so profound that there is no way that David Bowie is gonna reply to you. There's no follow-up for Black Star. Just like when John Lennon died, when his final album came out. There was no way to have a sequel. There's no way of continuity, and that protects the legacy. He's like stuck in that time.
I think this show here kind of pulling a little bit confused and contradictory perceptions. Remember earlier you mentioned about the wrong perception of time going slower and slower as you move away from the center. Okay, but in this case, you are mentioning you're facing the time and you're going towards the center of your facing, and things in this case go slower. Whereas when you're moving away from the center, you're increasing. So then these two are kind of
I would disagree
with what you mentioned, because if you read the next chapter, you're trying to propose, well, there's no concept of time. Now if we live our lives with pictures, there's no concept of time, there's a concept of pictures. And when we remember when we are young, we don't actually remember a certain, we don't actually know the time, but there is a concept of deja vu that we did this some time ago. Or sometimes when an old song comes out, we don't actually remember the actual time we actually first heard the song, but it actually resonates because it actually activates a concept of a picture. I think that the next chapter is actually saying
well,
that.
Well, let me make one comment. There was a comment here that there were two concepts that were contradictory to each other. The chapters are not supposed to be self-consistent. Each one proposes a different world, a different concept for time. So it's natural that there would be contradictions between different chapters. Yes?
As you explore in your 30 dream, different
concept of what time could have been, but it might be. Do you have a preference? Do you have any alternative to the current real physical time that you would like to have? Or do you like living as it is right now?
Yes. Well, the question is, do I have a preference for, I think I do have a preference. It's not for a particular one of the dreams, but I think in many of the dreams that people appreciate the preciousness of the moment. They're not trying to think what are they going to do the next day or the next day, but they're trying to live right in the moment. And this, I understand, is part of Buddhism, it's part of mindfulness, it's probably part of other religions as well. And I think that over my own lifetime, that I have gained more and more appreciation of how important living in the moment is, that I have learned both as a scientist and both as a student of Buddhism that nothing lasts, that everything is impermanent, that everything around us is passing away. Even our own children will pass away. All we have is the present moment, and we should fully experience the present moment. So, looking back on the book now, many years later, I can see that there were certain chapters where the moment was important, and I think those are the closest to my heart now. And I probably would not have understood that many years ago when I wrote the book. Yes.
Early on, there was a suggestion that the time is the construct of the human mind. It cannot be. To say that is a denial of reality, because we can observe that many biological and chemical processes are related to time.
Yeah.
You can't change it. So you can think in an abstract way and say that it is a construct of the human mind, but it is not realistic. You can't do away with time. It's a reality of our existence.
So this comment was that we cannot do away with time, that it's a reality, it's part of physical reality. I would say, and I'm speaking, I'm a physicist, but I would say that there is a psychological experience of time, a mental experience of time, which does not follow clocks. Sometimes you are doing very pleasurable things, and the time seems to be go by very quickly in your mind. And other times you're doing things that are very unpleasant and they seem to take a long time. That's a psychological experience. And I think that a lot of our, and now I'm speaking as an amateur here, because I'm not a professional in this area, but I think that a lot of our human experience, our art, our spirituality, and that whole realm of existence, the psychological experience of time is important. It doesn't mean that we throw away our computers and throw away our GPS and everything that depends on the physical nature of time, but we live in more dimensions, that we are complicated beings. We have an artistic side, we have a scientific side, and all of that is part of being human. And so I think that all of those different perspectives are important. In the book, there's actually one of the 30 dreams that actually corresponds to Einstein's theory of relativity. It's the dream in which people going faster, their time slows down. So people build their houses on wheels and try to go very fast. All the other 29 dreams I would say deal more with the psychological experience of time. Yes?
Regardless of all the scientific speculation, I think what you have done is very beautifully connected time with meaning. And meaning is essentially a human construct.
Yes.
So I think that's something that we cannot ignore.
Yes, yes. So this comment was that meaning is a human construct, and I totally agree with you that all of the science we have and all of the advances of science in the last few hundred years, all of the great technology that science has given us, it doesn't give us meaning. That you need the humanities and the arts for meaning. And that's why an institution of higher learning like WOU or like USM, they need to have all of those areas, the arts, the humanities, and the sciences, that they're all important together. You can't have one without the other. So thank you for your comment.
I actually have a question. You read all the dreams of Einstein. Imagination, was it thoughts, were arousing a lot of questions in him, which eventually gave some of the best answers the world was looking for. And I'm just wondering whether your book, while it does raise all the issues and questions, philosophically, artistically, and scientifically, is there any chapter which also provides the answers that Einstein found fully?
Unfortunately, not. I don't think there are any answers to some of these profound questions. Like, for example, what is the meaning of life? I think that each person has to seek their own answer. As I mentioned at the very beginning, Einstein, the book is not based upon actual dreams that Einstein had. So it's completely fiction that all of the dream worlds are things that I made up. I think that Einstein as a person was very interested in the humanities. He was a pacifist. He was against war. And he made a number of statements that relate to the human condition. He put a lot of value in education. But I don't think that he had answers to the profound philosophical questions of meaning that people have pondered for thousands of years. I would like to end with one last video, and this is going to be a dance performance that was done in London. And the quality of the picture is not that good, so we'll just watch a couple of minutes of this. So this is a dance that was written based upon the book. Thank you.
was to be given to the Vice Chancellor, I think, Professor Bo, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Lita, and the Dean of the School of Science and Technology, Professor Wendy Wong. Talks like this whenever we have a chance to get some people from